And you have a reason to give him that praise.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Let the worshipers come forth this morning as we lift up the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, oh, we've come to lift our hands and give him glory. We've come to lift our hands and give him praise. Everybody sing.
We've come to lift our hands and give him glory.
We've come to lift our hands and give him glory. We've come to lift our hands and give him praise. Everybody sing.
We've come to lift our hands and give him glory. We've come to lift our hands and give him praise.
Give him glory. To clap our hands and magnify him. We've come to clap our hands and give him praise. Everybody say,
we've come to clap our hands
as an act of worship. Hallelujah.
We've come to clap our hands and give him praise.
Oh, give him glory.
Give him glory.
We've come to clap our hands.
We've come to clap our hands and give him praise.
Church, we're gonna dance unto our Lord this morning. You're gonna dance away everything that is holding you back from your worship this morning. If it means you have to stamp those feet, we're gonna do some dancing this morning, because true worship is gonna come forth, because this is what God desires of us, true worship. Hallelujah, let me see you dance. We've come to do our dance and magnify him. To do our dance and give him praise. Everybody dance.
We've come to do our dance and magnify him. We've come to do our dance and give him praise.
Give him the glory.
Oh, give him glory.
We've come to dance.
We've come to do our dance and give him praise.
We come to dance unto Jesus.
To dance and give him praise.
Give God glory.
Oh, give him glory. We've come to lift our hands and give him praise.
Give God glory.
Oh, glory.
Let's do that again.
We've come to lift our hands.
We come to clap.
We've come to clap our hands.
We come to dance.
And we've come to do our dance and give him praise.
We come to dance,
church.
Let's do that one more time.
We've come to lift our hands.
We come to clap.
We've come to clap our hands.
Hallelujah.
We've come to do our dance and give him praise.
Hallelujah. We worship you this morning, God. We worship you not because we're deserving, but God, you have given us the privilege to be here this morning to worship you, unworthy as we are. And so we lift you up in spite of our circumstances. We worship you this morning and we sing some hallelujahs, because God, you deserve our hallelujahs and much more than that. And so we say to you, hallelujah.
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 worthy.
Give him glory.
Let's lift those hands to him.
We've come to lift our hands.
Let's clap on to Jesus. Let's dance for him.
We've come to do our dance.
Yeah, give him glory.
We've come to lift our hands and give him praise.
Give God glory.
And give him praise.
Put your hands together as we worship him this morning, because he's worthy. He's
hallelujah.
Worthy. Hallelujah.
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 Bless you, Lord.
You're worthy, God.
We have come to give God praise. Amen. You may be seated. Allow me this morning to welcome all of you on behalf of the leadership of Ecclesia Bible Fellowship. Are there any first-time guests among us today? Please, EBF, let them feel welcome. We thank you so much for coming out to fellowship with us, and we continue to give God thanks for you and for your family. At this time, the Tiny Tots will leave for Sunday school.
I am a promise with a capital P. I am a great big bundle of potentiality.
Oh yes.
And I'm learning to hear God's voice, and I'm trying to make the right choice. I am a promise to be anything God wants me to be. You are a promise. You are a possibility, you are a promise with a capital P. You are a great big bundle of potentiality.
Oh yes.
And you are learning to hear God's voice, and you are trying to make the right choice. You are a promise to be anything God wants you to be.
Good morning, church.
Good morning,
church. Okay, this church is here. I don't know what's over this side. Good morning, church. You guys not ready yet? Come on, we're here at church, right? You came to church this morning, right? You guys had breakfast this morning? You don't sound so. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Just want to give you some notice and just let you know what's happening. We know that we start here at what time, ladies and gentlemen? Yeah, not 9:30, not 9:15, 9 a.m. in the morning. Not 9 p.m. for some of us who don't remember either. And that we ask you that you come a little bit early, settle down, you know, and just help us start the service 9 a.m. sharp. We're inviting you to go on our site, our website. Is it there? Last week, our sister had spoken about our blogging. I hope we had more blogging this week. I don't know if Damon can testify to that.
We have lots of material there.
So we wanted to be key on this now. The WhatsApp number there is 822-5500. We have two visitors here. I don't think she have a smartphone as yet. You're not gonna buy her one? Not yet, soon, coming soon. And then we have another visitor over this side. I hope you have your WhatsApp number. Just take that down. We have worship on there in the mornings. We have devotions in the mornings and a lot of information. You can contact us by Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and telephone, and only between the hours of 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. and only emergency calls after 8 p.m. Right? We also have our counseling service available for Healing Arts Counseling Ministry. You are not alone. Is up there yet? Service is open to both members and non-members. Look, now I want to take down the number. Can you be surprised a lot of people need this type of service? And the number is 513-9144. And the same time applies, 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. You know, if you know anybody need a number, just to give a call. I don't want to necessarily speak to you, but we have counselors there and are readily available to answer the phone and provide that service. Right, Auntie Sashi, you know? Yes. Okay, anybody celebrating birthday this week? Birthday. Trey, your birthday is in December. Next week. They're too fast, man. Any other birthdays? Should we oblige her on a birthday today or wait till next week? Okay, I get your devote to thanks for the wait till next week. Not fair. Any anniversary? Anybody selling anniversary in January? There we have another next week. Alright? So no birthdays or anything like that. They're going to Sunday school? Oh, who's that?
It's Friday.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. And Sudi's birthday.
And Sudi, right.
Well, let's just sing Sudi a happy birthday and hopefully she hear from this side.
So what happened to Abby?
And you stand for Abigail? Yeah. The Tony can't stand for Abigail and wonderful sit down. Ready to lick, guys? And I'm very sure my son Zion will be remembering Abigail's birthday. You know, Daddy, Saturday, let's go, you know, or something like that. Also want to give you an opportunity of giving. And we remind you that there is a love basket to the back. Patrick, could you pick it up for me a second? Hold. Before you pull that, Patrick. Oh, the two Patrick's holding it. Patrick, your birthday is when? Thursday. Patrick, how old are you? 27? Two times that? Somebody say 1,000 years. I'm not going to say who. Happy birthday, Patrick. Wish you many, many more. You look as young as you are. 21, I think. I'm not sure. But anyway, let's get back to the love basket. Patrick, the other Patrick, no. That is not his birthday. You're right. Ladies and gentlemen, turn around to the back. Is the basket full, Patrick? Is it empty? Is there any item in there? There's one item, couple item. Wonderful. Church, you're at least you're putting item. We ask that you put non-perishable items in there. Things that you know, you pick up at the supermarket, you buy three of this, three of that, three of Grace, three of Carl's. Where's my Grace friend? She's here? Oh, yes, there she is. Wonderful. And Grace have some new products anyway, and we don't want to know about that, right? But put it in the love basket. You're surprised that a lot of our members benefit from that. You're not sure. It doesn't really matter. You don't need to know. It's just put something. Just take some from home. Remember, next week, just carry one item. I want to see it full, just like how it is full today. And then we also have an opportunity. You can give your other ways by our bank account. You see the numbers up there. And you can just take those down. And you just go to the bank. You just write the deposit the number, the account number on deposit. And you just put that in there, all right? On Fridays, we here at Liberty, we have Bible study. Last week, our pastor had referred that a lot of us don't come to the Bible study. I was there Friday, and it seemed that we all forgot. But I'm reminding you again. We're studying the book of Genesis, and it's very, very, very interesting. A lot of things that you may have conjured up in your head from other scriptures and stuff, you get the clarity there. And if even for me, last Friday I learned that, you know, the first sin was actually disobedience, if you check it out. But if it came, you'd understand. So it's Genesis, and we'll have it here on Friday, 6 p.m. And then we'll have it at Coldwell Bankers. I'm not sure if Stephen is here as yet, but he deals with that one. So you have two options. It is good that you come to church, but it's great that you come to Bible study. It's there that you go into the Word, and it's what makes us Christians and what we need to be good disciples and learning. So, guys, again, I'm calling you out. Please, this Friday, 6 p.m., want the room to be full, so that when it's even full, we'll say, you know what, we'll move from the room and we'll come back in the hall if we have to be, all right? Bible study is very, very, very important. All right. We also have corporate prayer. And this is Friday. This Friday. All right? So we're not having Bible study this Friday? It's going to be a part of Bible study. Okay, so we have corporate prayer this Friday. And that's the 29th. And also we have fasting on Wednesdays. We know we try to go through 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. And we pray for things in the aspect of the church, our members. And there are a lot of little things that you can fast also for personally if you want to. If you can't go to 6 p.m., I encourage you to do the 12. So you wake up in the morning on Wednesday, don't have anything, do a little prayer and go straight through the day. End it with a prayer and you participate in a very corporate sense with everybody here. We also have prayer request forms at the back there. Prayer request forms at the back building by guest services. And you can pick up one of those. The evangelist team meets every first Saturday at 3:30. And you will get more on that. And okay, there it is. So it's the first Saturday. So that won't be this Saturday, it'll be the next Saturday, right? All right. We are called to be disciples. Evangelism is discipleship. So we'll need a little more support here. All right, guys? All right. I know that we have our family events. We know that we have WOW. We have Men of Integrity. It's if Roach was here, I would have said, yo, you know. But anyway, where's Howard? Okay, then we'll talk about that later. And then we have the youths. Yeah. I love you guys. I miss being there. Okay, and that's Saturday at 4:30. And the next one is February 6th. Put it on your calendar. And guys, and there is an announcing it. guys, we also have other ministries that you can be a part of. And I'm going to go through the list, a long list. There is many places that your talent is available. So here we go. We have creative arts and dance. Anybody can dance? That means you're going to be at the ministry next week? Okay, we have one volunteer. Then we have music and singing. Anybody can sing? You can play music? Colin, you see the youth? You see the hands? All right. Then we have audiovisual. I call them the pointer guys. Up the stairs there. How many guys up there is participating in that? We have one, two. Want the youth to contribute, you know. We have that, no. Then we have guest service. Then we have decor. If you come to the hall, you notice that it's always clean and always nice and put together. And last week we spoke about that. And then we have Sunday school. I mean, I'm not a Sunday school person. If you want to participate, who likes to teach? I don't know about, you know, you can't go. You can't go. And then we have prayer and we have pastoral care and evangelism. There are so many ministries that you can participate in. All right? And these are the announcements. Thank you.
Now, I want to invite you to the most important aspect in the life of a church. Who can tell me what that is? Who can tell me what that is? Evangelism. Ephesians chapter 2 verse 10 tells us that we are saved unto good works. And part of that good work that we're saved unto is to establish the rule of God in the earth. And how are we going to do that? Through evangelism. Who knows when is the next big evangelism outreach? Huh? And when is that? March, end of month. Where we go there with our tracks, with our water bottles, and our water bottles are a track in itself. And we share the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now that costs money. Our budget for carnival outreach is, how much, Camille? $80,000. $80,000. And we're asking you to partner with us to make this outreach a reality and a success. Because we have bottles to purchase, labels to purchase, water to purchase, gas to put in the truck, tracks to make, and we make our own tracks. So it takes money to produce that. And we're asking you, encourage your children. If they can save $10 a day out of the school week, that's $50 a week, to make a contribution to this. Not just your money, we want your bodies. So we can have $80,000 and zero persons show up, then nothing happens. So we want you there. We also want you to be praying that God will prepare hearts to receive his word when we go out there. For no man can come unless the Spirit draws him. So we want you to be in prayer for that. So this Wednesday, as you pray, remember those who are not saved as we go. And remember too, little contribution. We need your contribution. So beginning next week, after you've given your offering, the guest services team will wait on you again for your special contribution towards evangelism. Amen? Amen. Thank you very much. Stand with us again, please. As we make melodies in our hearts towards our God. And this next song just talks about the beauty of salvation and the beauty of surrender to an awesome God who in his love and his mercy stepped into our reality to transform us for his glory. So Lord, here I am to worship and bow down and say you are God. Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that makes this heart adore you. Hope of a life, so here I am.
Here I am to say that you're my God.
You're all together worthy.
And
Lord, you're wonderful. Light of the world. You step
down into darkness.
And you open my eyes. Cause me to see
beauty that made this heart.
Lord, my heart adores you.
Hope of a life spent with you.
Oh, here I am to say
that you're mine.
King of all days,
oh so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, all for love's sake became poor. Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God.
You're all together wonderful
to me.
King of all days,
oh so highly exalted.
Oh yes, in heaven.
All together
worthy.
All together
Of love for me.
Hallelujah.
Here I am to worship.
Hallelujah.
Here I am in surrender, to bow down, to surrender to your will and to your purposes and to your plan. Here I am to say, you my God, and I am your child, and you're altogether wonderful. Say, here I am. And make this the prayer of your heart this morning. A prayer of surrender. Because he deserves it.
You're my God.
You're all together, Lord. And you're all together worthy. Lord, you're wonderful. You are, you're lovely, you're worthy, you're wonderful, you're amazing, you're glorious, you're awesome, you are awesome in this place, mighty God. You're awesome. And I have 10,000 reasons.
Hallelujah.
To worship him.
Amen.
10,000 reasons.
Hallelujah.
To give him glory.
Amen.
Because you see, circumstances change, but God never changes. He's immutable. He's sustaining.
Hallelujah.
He's awesome and he's wonderful.
Hallelujah.
Every time. Reason to bless the Lord. want you to do for me. Sorry, not for me. For yourself. Think about all of the things in your life that you think are going wrong. Just think about that for a second. And despite all of those things that you think are going wrong and have not gone the way that you wanted them to go, I want you to consider that you're still here, still standing.
Amen. That's amazing.
That despite all those circumstances that change, God has kept you standing.
Amen. Hallelujah.
You see, God does not need circumstances to go right to be faithful.
Amen.
Because in the midst of everything that is going wrong, He stands with you and He stands faithful.
Amen.
Is that a reason to give Him glory?
Yes.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. So
all of those things that you think are going wrong, those are reasons to say to your soul, bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, bless the Lord, worship His holy name.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Yeah.
in here.
I worship your holiness.
Come on, soul, worship.
I worship your holiness.
Come on, soul, worship.
I worship your holiness.
What are you cast down on my soul?
I worship your holiness.
What are you disappointed within me?
I worship your holiness.
Bless the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Bless the Lord.
Hallelujah. We bless
you. Oh, my soul.
Amen.
Oh, my soul. God deserves worship at all points of our lives, in the good times and in the bad times, because He remains God.
Amen.
All the time. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Bless.
Hallelujah. God is indeed a constant in our lives, and therefore we can trust Him. We can give God thanks for what He continues to do in and through our lives. Would you remain standing for the reading by our brother Ramesh?
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Okay, our scripture reading today will be taken from Hebrews chapter 10. I'll be reading from verse 32 to the end, and I'll continue into verse 3 of chapter 11. Okay, let's begin. Verse 32. But remember the former days when after being enlightened, you endured a great conflict of sufferings, partly by being made a public spectacle through reproaches and tribulations, and partly by becoming sharers with those who were so treated. For you showed sympathy to the prisoners and accepted joyfully the seizure of your property, knowing that you have for yourselves a better possession and a lasting one. Therefore, do not throw away your confidence, which has a great reward. For you have need of endurance, so that when you have done the will of God, you may receive what was promised. For yet, in a very little while, he who is coming will come, and will not delay. But my righteous one shall live by faith. And if he shrinks back, my soul has no pleasure in him. But we are not of those who shrink back to destruction, but of those who have faith to the preserving of the soul. Now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. For by it the men of old gained approval. Verse 3 and last. By faith we understand that the worlds were prepared by the word of God, so that what is seen was not made out of things which are visible. This is the end of the reading of scripture.
Thanks be to God. You may be seated as we continue in our worship service with the act of giving.
Peace.
This morning, and we just thank you for all that you do for us. Father, you are the sovereign God that has provided for us all. Father, just continue to touch our hearts so that we may give unto you, and free will giving be a normal activity, not just of funds, but of our time. Father, we thank you for all that you provide us with. And we look to you for everything in life as your children. Now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
Morning again. Just a quick announcement before we have our special item. The Kingston Keswick 2016, Following Christ, No Matter What, Sunday, January 4th to Sunday, January 31st. Nightly at 7 p.m. I guess, at Boulevard Baptist Church. You know that Boulevard Baptist on Washington Boulevard, right? Well, I hope I'm right. Nightly pre-service prayer session at 6:30 to 7 p.m. The main speaker, Reverend Dr. Stevenson Jennings. And then they have a men's meeting. Stephen Jennings. Sorry, my bad. And then there's a woman's meeting with Reverend Kareen Wilson Bailey. There's a children's meeting. This is Minister Andrew Adam. And these are, I'm assuming, during the week of the 24th to the 31st. And they have lunch hour speakers. It's at 12:15 p.m. with Reverend Shane, Reverend Wayne, Curtis Stewart, Mr. Don Lou Kolash, and I'm hoping I'm getting the name right, Dr. Len Anglin, and Reverend Teddy Jones, which I'm familiar with. When he had a lot of hair before on this picture. Right. So that's Sunday, January 24th to the 31st. So if you want to participate there, flyer by the guest service, you can just look at. All right? Thank you.
I want to express thanks and appreciation on behalf of the Pastoral Care Ministry. I want to tell you personally that we give God thanks for your commitment, that love basket, because it is having a significant impact on many individuals, both within this fellowship and some persons who don't attend this church. Give yourself, my EBA family, a big round of applause. We want to ask you to put your cell phones on vibrate and minimize the walking back and forth, as we would ask the Creative Arts Ministry to come and minister to us in dance. Only can clap them, man. And then he said, it's not a dance. Me call it dance. Sure. And after the dance, our pastor will come with the word.
Yeah. convinced. I don't care what you're going to tell me now. I am convinced when we get to heaven, right over the arts section, God have a little section there, Mark EBF. He sent us so many gifted people. Amen? I don't believe God sent us these sitting here and be entertained at all. I believe that with the vision that God has given the leaders, this is for us to use these to win others to the kingdom. Amen? So, you know, I told you this year is a different year. This year, who not coming, going to get left behind. Who is not coming, going to be left behind. And some people already tell you that them coming under pressure to see to it that those in the areas that we need them step up their game. We are moving forward with this vision. We are going to take Jamaica by storm, then the Caribbean. But we will proclaim the name of the Lord in every form and in every way. So, gear yourselves up. Hold tight, because we're taking off. Amen? Are you kind of aiming low with that one? The preteens. You're a preteen. Bye. They got so caught up with church this morning, they forgot. Normally, they'll be come touching me every minute to say, hey, we're not going out. We want to welcome all the deportees back. Those that they deported from Barbados, again, we take you back. As with the grace of God, we keep forgiving and take you. You know, you fly gone home, but you're going for holidays. See what happened? They send you back. We want to welcome those back, those who were abroad in America and were deported. We want to welcome them. Those who tried to migrate to Belize and were deported. We want to welcome them back. More. So we want to welcome you to church this morning. Why don't you stand? You stood this morning already, didn't you? Yes. And that's for all the deportees. And we missed two persons this morning who are here for the first time. Maybe three. Shanika, you have guests? First time? Oh, not first time. You see, when you take too long to come back, that's what happened. You know, we think it's the first time you come. But we have, Shelton has brought two guests this morning. So Shelton's guests, please stand. Record when the kids come out, it shows blank. So come up and fill out the empty spaces. Thank you. I am a firm believer in the arts. A very talented art director, though we fight so often, you know, because she just don't get the moves right when I show her it the first time, you know. But this morning they did well, didn't they? Yes. Yes. I was supposed to have dance this morning too, you know. I never liked the pants, so I never bothered with it. I don't like that pants at all, so. But he's really a gifted artist for the Lord. All right. We read the word this morning. Father, we pray by your Holy Spirit, you will bring conviction to the truth of your word. Help us, God, to be obedient. In Jesus' name. It is gratitude that prompted an old man to visit an old broken down pier on the eastern south coast of Florida. Every Friday night until his death in 1973, he would return walking slowly and slightly stooped with a bucket. Many years before, in 1942, October, Captain Eddie Reinbacher was on a mission on a B-17 to deliver an important message to General Douglas MacArthur in New Guinea. But there was an unexpected detour which would hurl Captain Eddie into the most harrowing adventure of his life. Somewhere over the Pacific, the Flying Fortress became lost beyond the reach of radio. Fuel ran dangerously low, so the men ditched their plane in the ocean. And for nearly a month, they would fight the water, the weather, and the scorching sun. They spent many sleepless nights recoiling as huge sharks rammed their craft. The largest raft was 9 by 5. The biggest shark was 10 feet long. But with all of their enemies at sea, one proved more formidable than the others. 8 days out of their rations were long gone or destroyed by the salt water, starvation started to set in. It would take a miracle to sustain them. And a miracle occurred in Captain Eddie's own word. Cherry, that was a B-17 pilot, Captain William Cherry. He read the service that afternoon, and we finished with prayer for deliverance and a hymn of praise. There was some talk, but it tapered off in the oppressive heat. This is him speaking. With my hat pulled down over my eyes to keep out some of the glare, I dozed off. Something landed on my head. I knew that it was a seagull. I didn't know how I knew, I just knew. Everyone else knew too. But peering out from under my hat brim and without moving my head, I could see the expression on their faces. They were staring at the gull. The gull meant food, if I could catch it. And the rest, as they say, is history. They caught the gull. Its flesh was eaten and its intestines used for bait to catch fish. The survivors were sustained and their hopes renewed because of a lone seagull. That uncharacteristically flew hundreds of miles from land and offered itself as a sacrifice. Captain Eddie and those men made it. And you know, that's why for as long as he lived, he would go down to the pier and feed the gulls in remembering of one gull, his life was saved. Our passage begins with an exhortation to remember. Hebrews is a tough book. And this is one of the tough passages that we're not touching. Don't need to, because we have done the book of Hebrews before. But he's just finished getting through warning them of the perils of forsaking their fellowship with God and ultimately their fellowship with each other. You know that when you stop fellowshipping with God, you eventually stop fellowshipping with each other. This was due to trials and tribulations that were coming towards them. They were facing challenges that they felt were insurmountable. They were under the gun, as it were. And many of them had decided that they would turn back from following Jesus and return to something lesser, Judaism. And for the entire book, he has spent telling them it makes no sense to leave better for worse. And that all that you might see now, being in Christ, is far superior than anything else. And he's told them in chapter, 5, 6, that you can't leave Christ. Why? Because Christ selected you to himself. And you can't walk out of salvation, because it would mean to undo the work of Christ. And if you undid the work of Christ, if you could, it would mean that you could never, ever be saved again. You know, some people teach that. You can lose your salvation and then repent. The Bible is clear. If that could happen, then you would never be able to repent. Why? Because if you undid the work of Calvary, it would require Christ dying again. And Christ is never going to die again. His death was once and for all times, irrevocable, unchangeable, everlasting. So he warned them. It makes no sense. And he just told them that if you try by forsaking, then you will incur the wrath of God for trampling over his grace. You might not lose your salvation, but you incur God's wrath because you have trampled on his grace. But he didn't just leave it there in the warning. He left them with a word of encouragement. He says, but remember. Remember. The word remember is not just recalling. It doesn't mean that you just sit down and think about it. It means to be consistent and to carefully go over in detail. It's not a slight remembrance. This is sitting down and thinking through it intently and intensely. He says, remember the former days. Almost a reminder for them to think about their early love. Their early love, when they just got saved, and how they would come across the same sort of persecution. They endured a great conflict of suffering, he says. Partly by being made a public spectacle. They were teased and they were embarrassed openly. This is open persecution. And he's reminding them about that. He says, how you endured the reproaches and the tribulations, and that you became sharers by those who were treated that way. You were one with them. You didn't try to separate yourself. The fellowship remained strong despite that. You showed a sympathy to those that were imprisoned and accepted joyfully the seizure of your property, knowing that you have for yourself a better possession and a lasting one. Remember, he says, you have been here before. You've done this before. And what took you through that time was one that you overcame. And he's saying, now that you face persecution, now that life suddenly turned hard to you again, remember the time when you overcame. things that I've noticed about Christians. As you say anything to them, what I'm going to do? Pack up and leave. Yes. You say anything to anybody, and the first thing they are going to tell you is, I'm going to leave. It's not new. It happened then. You see, we believe that we are here because we choose to be here. We believe that we're in control of our lives and our destiny. So we then believe with that we can haul up and go anywhere we want and do anything we want, regardless of what God is saying to us. On their life was God's call on their life. First and foremost, God called you here. So you can't just pick up and walk off because God called you. Me can go somewhere else. Really? When people come with that attitude, when people come without staying power, when people come without real commitment, they're unreliable. They're unreliable. It means when the going gets tough, you have nobody to rely on. He reminds them that in that time, you could depend on each other. You became a part of those that were in prison. You became a part of those that were suffering. You fellowship. You stuck it out. And God delivered. And now he's saying, remember. Remember. Remember, God has done it already. That's the first thing. Then number two, he says, focus. 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 I showed you a video, and I was going to show it this morning, but showed you a video some time ago with Usain Bolt training. Then he goes over into a corner and pushes his hand down his throat and begins to vomit. And the coach says, you all right? And him say, yes, coach. Him say, well, come again. Our own friend, though we don't see him so much these days, and pretty soon won't see much of him because he barely have anything to say, no. Has lost so much weight since he ran for Calabar. Now he's training in Germany. And he tells us how hard the training is. How hard the training is. What do you think keeps these athletes to that kind of grindstone and mill? What do you think caused them to get up 5 or 4 o'clock every morning and gone out there in all this cold and run up and down and run up and down and run up and down and run up and down, and when I'm tired and can't go anymore, run again? What do you think causes them to do this every day? I remember when I was younger, lived in Harborview, we would go jog every morning. And one of the persons that I became friends with long before he became a household name was Michael McCollum. That's the name of the boxer, right? I said that. McCollum. And he, every morning, when we don't go, and when rain fall, and when it's too cold, and we walk till nobody can see it, and sit down and wait a little bit, then start run again, come back. He would jog all the way to and from. Every day he was out there, rain or shine. Geoffrey Dujon, when he was about to make the West Indies team playing for Jamaica, the match would be over and all the players are gone and he would be in the nets with the groundsmen bowling to him and batting and batting and batting. There was a persistency and a commitment. You know why? Because they weren't seeing their situations that they were in. They were looking beyond that and looking to the prize. Looking to the prize. Verse 35. Therefore, do not throw away your confidence, which has a great reward. Commitment born out of their eyes on the prize. This past week, not past World Games, not many people held much of a hope for Usain. Tell the truth, you may as well confess, you're in church. I believe he would win, but I was as nervous as, didn't even want to watch a race. He was nervous too. But his coach reminded him when he ran a bad semi-final. His coach came over and said to him, run your race. Just run your race. All the commentators, all the sports persons wrote him off. Even those that were commentating said, well, this might be the upsetting. And you know, the might was more will than might. And he got up. And he began to run. And though people say Gatlin was never ahead, they must have been watching a different race. I watched that, when he was ahead and Usain started to pull up beside. You saw that? It reminded me of my friend who is a mechanic. I had a 2002 BMW. No, that's not the year. That's the model. You know, you guys don't know about car and stuff. 2002 BMW. And he had a VW that he had souped up. He's a VW mechanic. And coming down Mountain View one day, he decided to challenge me. Pull up beside me. I was ahead. I never even saw him. And looking over and, you know, revving. Just shut him up. So I slipped into third and started to pull, looking at him all the time with a smile. And slowly the smile moved from his face as I started to just inch past him. And when I pushed it into fourth, that's fourth speed, the car leaped and he was left behind and blew up his engine. I never saw him for about a month. See, that's what happened to Bolt when he looked at the prize that was ahead. When he remembered what he was defending was his own glory, honor. He pulled beside Gatlin and he couldn't find anything and he blew up. You remember? Hands going one way, foot another way, head another way, almost died. The prize. If you talk to Gatlin, he will tell you what could cause an old man like him to come back with so much effort and keep trying to win. He's trying to recapture the glory of winning before. No athlete goes out there and don't push because of that little piece of tread. It's not even tread anymore, it's light. Because of what it represents. And strive for the reward. Since you haven't gotten it yet, that God is worthy of everything that you can do and more besides, he says, think of his promises and strive for the reward. And that's not ungodly. Peter does the same thing. 1 Peter chapter 1. Peter says, blessed be, verse 3, the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has caused us, according to his great mercy, to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to obtain an inheritance which is imperishable, undefiled, and will never fade away, reserved for you in heaven. Peter was using the same kind of thing to encourage those Christians too. He used the glory of the Olympics and a wreath would sooner or later wither up and dry. You ever wonder why these guys throw away the flowers as soon as them get it? Going wither up and dry is a gold medal that stays. Peter says, if you can strive so hard for that, strive even harder for the prize of the higher calling. And if you can't focus on God and his deserving of everything that we have, then think about his promises. A reward that is imperishable, that is undefiled, that is reserved, guaranteed. Run. Then he tells them to persevere. For you have need of endurance, so that when you have done the will of God, you may receive what was promised. You have need to persevere. We live in an age where Christians believe and things happen. We're walking around with wands and sticks. Not literally, no. And top hats, thinking that life is something that we pull rabbits out of our hats and doves out of our coats. And yes, I said boops. Now, well, you see, them just pretending. Because I don't have anybody. Those who wouldn't know, go on to Sunday school. So unless you never have radio, you know what boops is. As if to say, and you know, we carry the same thing. God, if this don't happen, I'll stop serve you. And I hear people saying that. I hear preachers encouraging. God owes us something. And if it don't come true, then, you know, we can call it quits. Come out of that attitude. Endure, he says. What does endure mean? Put up with it. Put up with it. Stand against that desire to stop. We used to have security guards, you know, and when we were going to important events and we needed all hands on decks, I used to tell them, absolutely no excuse. Everybody has to be there. You don't come from that level of discipline, so you don't understand. The army people and the police officers understand. Yeah? Absolutely none. If you're sick, we'll find somewhere that you can stay. Then I told them, and not even if you die, you're excused. Get somebody to put on the uniform, we will catch it up. See? Endurance. Why? The prize. The reward. The promise. Remember, he says, all of these things. So that when you have done the will of God, notice what perseverance causes us to do? Carry out the will of God. The will of God is not some little flimsy thing that you can just run in and run out as you have a mind. God's will is to bring us to a place of maturity in Him. And that means that we're going to go through some things, and He's going to use us in that state of maturity to do His work. And that don't come by sleeping late and all one morning. That don't come because rain falling and boy, I'm a cow, but I go there today. I make past them sit on about him gone to church. That don't come by us giving ourselves excuses as to why we're not in Bible study. That doesn't come by us continuing to give ourselves an excuse when we fail to walk in obedience. That I find the church is so willing to do. So why, you know, what if Jesus, when he came and saw the cross before him in that garden of Gethsemane, declared, you know, this look rough. And I went busy for a little while, make it stay till half time. He took on humanity with all its weakness and its shortcomings so that he could demonstrate to us that you can indeed do these things. And he did it, the Bible says, according to what? The power of the Spirit within him. And God has made sure that he has given us that very Spirit to dwell in us. So we are without excuse. And start. When we're faced with it, nevertheless, Lord, not my will, but your will be done. So, he tells them to persevere so that when he comes, you will receive your reward. Then he tells them, he says, now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. That is what we call in Hebrew language a parallelism, where the first line is repeated in the second. You notice it. Faith is the assurance of things hoped for. And the second line, the conviction of things not seen, is the same thing that was just said. So it is not a theological definition of faith. I know most of us like to grasp that. What is faith? Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Well, that is not a theological definition of the word faith, nor does it embrace all of what faith is. What the author is doing, he's emphasizing something so that you could understand what you need to use in order to be victorious. Faith is what you need to use. And he's saying to you, faith does not always reveal itself in the obvious. As a matter of fact, faith, most times you cannot see what it is promising, but you have to hold on to it and believe. But this is not no willy-nilly faith. that you dream of something and you come and you say, in the name of Jesus, as if that is to change anything. Faith still is, according to what Romans says. Romans tells us that faith is or comes by what? Hearing. And hearing what? By the word of God. So faith comes to us and we know that because God said certain things and we remember what God says. We remember what God says for the moment. So he's emphasizing it. He's saying you don't have to see what's promised. You don't have to know that it's gonna come or when. You might not even live to see the fulfillment of the promise. But God is going to come. It's an assurance that God is going to do it. Why? Because God gave his word. Absolutely certain. That's what faith is. The absolute certainty of God carrying out his purpose plan despite what circumstances says. And if you didn't get that, he says, for it the men of old gain approval. Men of old, talking about men through the ages. When you read your Bible and you start, and he's about to launch into that, you know, of all these men through the Bible and how God made promises to them and they never saw it, but they continued to live believing God that he would honor what he said. It didn't change them, their circumstance, most times immediately, but they continued nonetheless. And what we see when we read the Bible is that God is faithful and will carry out his purpose and word. That's what he's saying. Can I have 5 minutes? Show the hands of those who give me 5 minutes. Five. Okay. I have about an hour. That will do. By faith, we understand that the worlds were prepared by what is seen. Not by the word of God, so that what is seen was not made out of things that are invisible. We're doing this in Genesis, you know. By faith, stand, because you weren't around when it was created. You came, you saw the world, and you wonder how it got there. Well, Genesis tells us how it got there. It said that in the beginning, God looked out, and there was nothing but darkness on the land. And God called light to come into being. In the beginning, God said to the waters, part up and let land come forth. And land came to being. God said, vegetation grow, and trees and shrubs came about. God said, let animals come forth. And animals came forth. Then God created man. The term we described it in the Bible study is ex nihilo. It means out of nothing. God created the world out of nothing. By faith we understand that. Why? You weren't there, but you are told and you believe. Well then, faith still carries that same request to it. That you might not see how the end is going to be, but you believe God. That out of your nothingness, God is going to bring forth something. You can always keep your applause and don't want to celebrate God when you remember these things, you know. I will rejoice. He's reminding us, go back and read and see what God did. God honored them that had faith. Then he talks about brother Abel. And he didn't even mention his other brother. That both of them were called to give sacrifice. But one obeyed God And as a result of him obeying God from as far back as Genesis, you continue to read about him here in the Old Testament, here today in this generation. His name stands as a testimony because he believed God that he was offering the better act of worship. Then he talks about Brother Enoch. You know him? Enoch was the one that was not, for God took him. In a time when men were walking away and shedding God, Enoch stood with God. The Bible says he walked with God. To walk with God means to be in rich fellowship with God. It means to be in full obedience to God. Let me ask you, can anybody say you are walking with God? Can they? Is that your testimony? Enoch walked with God. And the Bible says that God took him. God didn't cause him to see death. God called him up to himself. And to this day, Enoch dwells with God. When you read Jude, you realize something else, because Jude tells us of one of the prophecies that Enoch made. How did Enoch know what was going to happen? That don't happen now, no. Well, very simple. When you move and fellowship with God, God reveals his purpose to you. And Enoch stood fast. For that hasn't come yet. He stood fast. And then he mentions Brother Abraham. And he talks to Brother Noah first. Abraham he spends the whole time dealing with. Noah was called to obedience to build an ark when them never even know anything boring. I haven't been to the waters yet. Here is Noah building something and telling people God going to judge. God going to judge. And how many years Noah continued to build this ark with the same message, God going to judge. And they would gather and they would laugh and they would tease. Noah, warm to the rain. If they were like some of you who are troublesome, not like me, they would probably take all the hose and spray a little bit. Now where's the rain at? And have a good laugh. But Noah continued to be relentlessly faithful to what God said. Every time Noah felt like giving up, he remembered. And the Bible says Noah and his entire family was delivered because of his obedience. Noah still stands as a testimony. Then he talks about Brother Abraham. Abraham, come go somewhere where you don't know, I'm going to make you great. And Abraham gets up and goes. Kind of foolish is that. Even when God calling you to place, you know you're not going, much less. And it's God saying, come, we're going to go over here. So Abraham, you want, just come. Abraham goes, and into the time that Abraham goes, God begins to mold him and shape him so that he could become the father of faith. He promises him children more than the sands of the sea and the stars of the heaven, and gave him none. And Abraham was 100 years old and his wife 99 when God came and reminded them of the promise, because what? Sure as fate, they had forgotten. God changed his mind. And when Abraham was reminded of the promise, Sarah laughed. But it's not accounted here. What Hebrews says is that because she believed, when she believed or when she was reminded and finally believed, we don't know, but she did believe. And as a result of that, she had one son. God going to promise you millions and give you one. Abraham never lived to see Israel become a nation. But it didn't stop God from honoring his word. And Abraham finally have one son. And God said to him, come, 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 bring him, come, give me. Sacrifice him. And the Bible says Abraham willingly got up the morning early and left Mrs. Abraham at home with Sarah. Because you know how women be? They get to the place, what are you going to do? No, you must have mad. Give me my son. And she didn't tell her a word. He just said, we'll soon come. We're going to offer sacrifice. Notice the word that Abraham said to her. We will soon come. But God said, we're going to kill the boy. Abraham says, we will come back. How did he get there? Because he remember God said, this is the seed that I'm going to use. So even if God said, give it up, because God can bring it back to life. Give it up, because God will still multiply. Give it up, because God will honor his word. So Abraham came to that place where he was willing to give it up. When I was reminded by God of the call on my life to go to Bible school, it was a very inappropriate time. I had gotten caught up with business. Business had exceedingly abundantly done well. We had close to 300 persons employed. So numbers don't frighten me. We worked in areas that most of you could only hear of. We rubbed shoulders with people who you only see on TV and read about them in the papers. They were on first name basis. So importance don't frighten me. You know, some of us get to a little level or we're not even important yet and we start behave like we're so important. That boy, God have to make an appointment to come talk to us. You know, you're so busy. You know, everything you have is so important, more than what God has to say to you and what God has planned for you, that God must take a number and wait for his turn to come up. And on the verge of all of that, God comes in and he writes to us a contract worth millions of dollars. And this is not the first one. We had one, we have these people we were working with already. Their check that they would pay us every 2 weeks would pay our entire staff payroll check for the month. So it meant every 2 weeks of all of that. And I'm talking about what we collected from the other company. I'm not bragging, I'm making you know what God can do. Right in the midst of that, they called and they offered us a contract that would have caused us to have doubled up our numbers. We would have been the biggest company this side of the world. And the vice president called. And when I didn't jump in response to the offer, the president called. He said, listen, take your time. You know, you decide how you're going to do this. But you are who we want for this contract. And God, with his timing, came and reminded me. Remember when he was at UTEC and they tell us, I want to go to Bible school? I don't change my mind, you know. Bible school time. Bible school time. And I went and didn't get through to the Bible school that I was planning to go. See, sometimes, you know, we think we move in obedience when we do things how we want it and says God. Because I went to find a school in Florida so that, you see, I could go school Monday, Tuesday, be home, fly home Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. I would be good. Go back Monday, Tuesday again. And so I'm doing both things and God, all right, and me, all right. And everything went wrong. And the day when I went to finally check it out and got up there so I could make my decision where to go, locked. Embassy was closed. It's an American holiday. And I said, yes, Lord, I hear you loud and clear. You're not calling me to no Bible school. I got into my office and I called ahead. My sister was administrator and I said, listen, get all the managers, get the supervisors, you get everybody together. We're going to make a plan to take over this business. Call Mr. So-and-so and tell him, say, yes, we're taking the contract. He said, all right. Some reason she delayed, and when I got there, I said, call him. She said, not yet. I said, but everybody else is here. By the way, I have a letter from you from Albert. Albert, who went to Bible school in somewhere in America. 5 years Albert went to Bible school. Albert never write me one time. What happened now? Then all of a sudden, I see, I get the thing, and in it is not from Albert, but a letter from a school that I never heard about in a place where I've never been, Atlanta. What name so? Telling me that they have accepted my application. Which application? These people must have mad. I never see. Is who could have used my name doing? Then a little piece of stick note fell out. From Albert's wife, dear Barry, I remember some years ago you said you were thought about Bible school. And for some reason, I felt compelled to apply in your name. She works in the dean's office. This is no joke. This is dead serious thing. It's funny, yes, you can laugh, but I'm serious. And the dean, without my application, approves my application, and I have 4 weeks. To leave the country. 4 weeks. And as they say, the rest is history. God never finished then. When I hurried up and finished Bible school in 3 years, that I should have done it in four. I have to come back. The business is still there. Every holiday I come home and I reestablish contacts and we build and the contract, the guy sees me and he says, boy, you know, I said, listen, I told you I had to go to Bible school, but they're soon finished. And he said, the moment you step back in this country, let me know, it's yours. So I'm coming home every holiday. Listen, this man called me one Christmas, the morning after I came, the night. I said, how did you even know that I am here? He said, I have ears everywhere. You back now? I said, no, not yet. I finished in summer. I'm sorry, good. That summer, God gave me a full scholarship to Dallas Theological Seminary. Full scholarship with a job, health benefits, everything except a home, books included. It's crazy. They stepped up the scholarship to give it to me. And I sat down and I wept. God, who is in Texas? You're moving me from a place of nobody don't know me to a worse place. You're abandoning me. What am I going in Texas to do? I'm going, let me go to New York. I get a half scholarship in Washington. That's good. I can go over to New York 3 hours away. Drive over every week. God says, Texas. I wept. And all my household with me. My first week in Texas. My friend and I sat down in the classroom. And because it wasn't classroom time yet, he decided he was going to do something useful, budget. And I decided to do that useful thing with him. And we started to do our budget. Now, budget is something easy. income, that means all the money that's coming in on one page. Expenditure or outcome on the other page. You subtract one from the other, and then you know how you're working, or you compare them, you know. Income, three lines. Expenditure, 1.5 page. Food wasn't in it, and clothes wasn't in it yet. I never heard a word the professor said. For 2 weeks, my head felt it was going to explode. God, how could you? How could you, God? And one day when I sat there depressed, my friend who was depressed with me at that time, but overcame his depression, looked at me and said, "Hey, Bear, are you still thinking about that thing?" I said, "Yes." And he says, "How long is it since you have been here?" He said, "Did anything change in your income that month?" "No." "Were the expenditure the same?" "Yes." "Who do you owe?" "Nobody." And said, "Well, just leave it like that." If God took you through 1 month, God is going to take you through the next month, and the next month, and the next month, and the next month. 4 years God took us through. 4 years. And then God decided to show off the first and only new vehicle I ever bought was bought there without credit. When the guy said to me, "You know, you want this one?" And I said, "Well, you know, it's a used car I come for." He said, "Why are you buying used, man? You have no warranty." "Because I can't afford new." He says, "The used part is down there, but come, let me show you a vehicle." Takes me to a brand new van. They had three of them because they were new and special. One left, and he's walking towards the van, and a couple is looking at the van. And this man don't know me from Adam, says to the salesman that he's talking to, hey, I don't remember his name, but like he said, "Tom, hey, Tom, I reserved that van for this customer. He's taking it." You know, I stopped and looked behind me. What's he talking about? Tom left the van. You know, these people could have bought the van cash. I don't have the money. I don't have the paid on money. It's trade. And an accident. What I mean by that? Somebody ran into the back and insurance gave us some money. The back didn't show the damage, but they gave us a little money. They were hoping that we wouldn't sue, so they padded it a little bit. Here I am. I said to the guy, "I'm at school. I have no credit. You don't buy anything in America without credit." And the guy says, "Don't worry about that. Just sign here. We'll do some application for you." I got three letters that week telling me, "You were not approved." Then the guy calls me 4 o'clock Saturday and says, "Hey, Barry, aren't you coming?" I said, "For what? I got the letters and it said I wasn't approved." He said, "Hey, man, don't pay that no mind. I have 6 here that says you're approved." I go over for the car and there are the papers and he says, "Sign." When I'm driving in, there's a van washed with a big sold sign on it. And I say, "Oh, thank God, it's sold." And I go inside. You see, faith is not easy when you're not seen, you know. And I go inside and the guy says to me, "Hey, you ready?" I said, "But the car is sold." He says, "No, that's your sign." And I begin to tell him that I'm a Christian. Hear the testimony. I'm a Christian. I have to pray about this first. I am not sure if God wants me to have this. And he says, "Well, he has a strange way of saying no." I have to pray over it. And I walk away and leave the van. And I tell him, Wednesday, I let him know. Wednesday, he calls and I'm saying, "God, you still don't tell me no yet, you know. I'm not asking God for yes, I'm asking him for no. Why? Because I don't know where the money is coming from. Income still hasn't changed. I want to change expenditure to make things worse. And God reminds me, I am here because of him. And I said, well, all right, God, tell me for sure Saturday. Saturday, I tell the guy. The guy calls me back on Saturday, and I said, tomorrow, Sunday. No joke. Who you know going to do that? Don't know me from Adam. Still don't know, because if I walk and step into him, he wouldn't even remember me. And I went the Sunday with a cloud of unhappiness. Can you imagine somebody getting a new car and unhappy? Just like how I got the scholarship and I was unhappy. And here I am, and I go in, and the guy says, congratulations, calls his boss out, and they start celebrating. I bought a van. And I'm driving home the van, and it's so surreal. I'm saying, this must be a dream. How we manage to pay this? How am I going to pay this? This is $300 a month. 3 years after that in Florida, I sat down one day when a letter came to me that says, congratulations, Mr. Hall. You have completely repaid your loan. I don't know how it happened, but God, who was faithful to take me there, was faithful to keep me, was faithful to provide, was faithful despite everything else telling me it's not going to happen. So I come to Jamaica. And 2 years ago, we're driving on the road, and something clicked to us. We need a car. 2 or 3 years ago. I've asked Maureen when. She'd tell you. And we're looking at a car for her. And all of a sudden, it's not her the car is for anymore. It's me. And God presents to us a Prada. On the day when Dudus was raised in Cane Down, Tivoli, I'll never forget it. No money again but God. Every time something comes up now, I remind myself that the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Enoch, of Gideon, of all those that he tells us in chapter 11, that is too many to remember, add Barry Hall to it, that God will provide, will make a way, will keep his word, will honor his word to you. Remember. And if you don't have a story or a testimony, read theirs. That's why he put it in the Bible. So that if you're a young Christian or you don't have any testimony like this that you can recall, he says, check the others. Check to see what I have done and see if I will not do it again. Remember.
Hallelujah. What a word this morning, eh? And the song kept ringing in my ear. I feel like pressing, I feel like running. Remember that song? Yeah, man. Would you stand for the benediction? I'm going to ask our brother Norris to come and assist with that benediction for us. I'm happy that God is not a partial God. And he doesn't show favor or favoritism to people. And what he did for our pastor, guess what? He'll do it for you. Amen?
Amen.
The benediction.
One second.
It would be remiss if I didn't say this. This not on? Don't need yours.
He'll do it for me too.
Did you hear the worship team this morning? The others I have praised all the time, but there's one that is on it for a first time this morning. Come here. See her? You remember her? What? A month ago she got baptized. Remember? 2 months. 2 months ago. And a month after that she came and she said she can't sing. I said, really? Come do, what do you do again? Audition. And see, God has strengthened our numbers. God has given us some wonderful voices. You heard her this morning? They gave her a little solo part. You heard her? I stayed her and down there, and you could tell, you know, that she knew. She looked at me and smiled. And I looked across, and her face was shining bright over on the eastern side. Where is she? Oh, she's in the south now, you know. On the eastern side, that's her daughter. Full of pride. I don't think that your son, with all his glory and everything, and we give him that, made you as proud as to look up and see your daughter serving God this morning. All right, we can take him for an audition too. Amen. I use that to say, you need to start making yourself available. Some of you have walked away from ministries because you felt challenged, or somebody said something, or somebody did something, and you get vexed and you walk. Here's an opportunity of grace. Come back. And serving Robert, God knows him couldn't pay you. You're not serving me, I worse couldn't pay you. You're serving the risen God. And he says, endure. Amen?
Benediction, please. To him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy. To him be glory, majesty, power, and authority through Jesus Christ, O Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore. Amen. God bless you.
Hallelujah. When we remember all that you've brought us through, all that you've brought us over, and all that you brought us around, our soul bless you.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul.